welcome to Parma, Greece, United Church of Christ, and we're glad you've chosen to worship with us today. My name is Lauren Oster. Glad to see everyone. If you're worshiping with us in the sanctuary, please join us for coffee hour in the fellowship hall after the service. It is down the hall where the restrooms are also located. If you're visiting with us today, please take a moment to sign our guest book. You will find the book on the left by the main entrance. If there's anything we can do to make your visit with us more pleasant, please let us know. If you're joining us remotely, please take a moment to send us a comment and let us know what you think. Whether you are here in the sanctuary or watching us online, today you are part of the Parma, Greece family. We are glad that you are worshiping with us today. There are some announcements printed in your bulletin. Please have a look at those and see what is going on this week. So I'm going to open it and look. We can look together. Next week, Neighbors in Need offering. You should have gotten an envelope in the mail. There's some envelopes here. World Communion Sunday and Jubilee Sunday. Monday, Stewardship and Missions is a electric meeting via Zoom. And please call Pastor Jesse for her office hours from 10 to noon on Tuesday, and Wednesday from 6 to 8 p.m. Thursday, Pastoral Relations, and next Sunday, 22nd Sunday after Pentecost. Of course, the food shelves are looking for many things, including macaroni and cheese and PB&J. Are there any other announcements that need to be shared with our group? If you have a cell phone, please take a moment to either turn it off or turn to silent mode. And now, with the ringing of the church bell, let us begin our morning worship.
All Saints Day.
Oh, sure. Okay. Thank you. November 3rd is our yearly celebration of All Saints Day. Sheila needs the names of loved ones who have passed in the last year, since last November. Please have those to Sheila by 10/31/24. There's also information in the newsletter. See Sheila, as I said, with more information. Thank you.
Again, and welcome to the Parma, Greece United Church of Christ, where no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. My name is Pastor Jesse Liu, and I'm glad that you've chosen to worship with us today, either in person or online. Before we begin, and while we enjoy Laura's music, I would like you to meditate on a quote by the East Indian musician Ravi Shankar. Never underestimate your life. It is most precious. You never know what talents are hidden within you and what you have to offer to the world.
Thank you.
Please join me now in our responsive call to worship, which is taken from Psalm 8. O Lord, our Sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
You have set your glory above the heavens.
When I look at the heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars,
what are human beings that you are mindful of them, mortals that you care for them?
You have made them a little lower than God and given them dominion over the works of your hands. O Lord, our Sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Please stand now in body or spirit and join us in singing our opening hymn, number 492, I Would Be True. Pausing in the morning sun, we come before God. Let our hearts be warmed and our spirits stirred like flames dancing on a candle's wick. We come before God. Let us open our hands, meet the eyes of our neighbors, and come before God. Like rustling leaves blowing in the autumn wind, bright with color, deep when gathered, we now fall gently into the presence of God. Children's time, and I see one young person, but maybe not that young, so we will forego that for now and move right to the reading of the word.
Our Hebrew scripture this morning comes from the book of Job,
chapter 1, verse 1, and chapter 2, verse 1 through 10. There was once a man in the land of Uz, whose name was Job. That man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. One day, the heavenly beings came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them to present himself before the Lord. The Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From going to and fro on the earth and from walking up and down on it." The Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil. He still persists in his integrity, although you incited me against him to destroy him for no reason." Then Satan answered the Lord, "Skin for skin, all that people have they will give to save their lives. But stretch out your hand now and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will curse you to your face." The Lord said to Satan, "Very well, he is in your power. Only spare his life." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and inflicted loathsome sores on Job from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. Job took a potsherd with which to scrape himself and sat among the ashes. Then his wife said to him, "Do you still persist in your integrity? Curse God and die." But he said to her, "You speak as any foolish woman would speak. Shall we receive the good at the hand of God and not receive the bad?" In all this, Job did not sin with his lips. For the word of God in Scripture.
Thanks be to God.
And our epistle reading is from the book of Hebrews, chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, and chapter 2, verses 5 through 12. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets, but in these last days he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being, and he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. Now God did not subject the coming world about which we are speaking to angels, but someone has testified somewhere, "What are human beings that you are mindful of them, or mortals that you care for them? You have made them for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned them in glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet. Now in subjecting all things to them, God left nothing outside their control. As it is, we do not yet see everything in subjection to them, but we do see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, now crowned with the glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, "I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you." For the word of God among us.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel reading today is from the book of Matthew, chapter 5. Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the poor, pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when men revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so men persecuted the prophets who were before you. You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltness be restored? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trodden underfoot by men. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hid. Nor do men light a lamp and put it under a bushel, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." For the word of God within us.
Praise
to you. Will you pray with me? Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. It's October, the 10th month of the year. It's hard to believe that 2024 is nearly done. We only have a couple of months left, and I think most of us are grateful that this year will soon come to an end. It's been a year of fear, stress, loss, and challenge. It's been a year of change and transition. But it's October, and despite our anxiety, we're surrounded by autumn's glory. There are so many reasons to love autumn: cooler weather, sweaters, less crowded parks and trails, fewer mosquitoes, more soups and stews, pumpkin spice, squash, gourds. I could go on forever. But the best and certainly brightest reason to love autumn, especially here in New York, maybe what happens to the leaves. So what exactly does happen to the leaves? They change from green to yellow and orange and red and even purple and magenta, but why? What causes this awesome transformation? Here is a short science lesson from Wikipedia, and you've probably heard this before. The compounds responsible for the yellow and orange-red hues are actually present in the leaves all year long. But they're overwhelmed by high levels of vivid green chlorophyll during the summer months. Chlorophyll is necessary for photosynthesis, the process by which plants use sunlight to make food from carbon dioxide and water. Leaves can only produce that chlorophyll in the presence of warmth and sunshine, which of course becomes scarce starting in late September. As chlorophyll production slows and then stops, the yellow and orange, red and purple compounds are able to shine through. So, in a nutshell, these colors are there all along, but they don't show up until the tree is denied sunlight and warmth and loses its chlorophyll. As the tree starves, as it suffers this shortage, its true colors shine through, more brilliant, more dazzling than ever before. And now you're an expert. We here at Karma Greece United Church of Christ have experienced shortages this year. We've adopted an austerity budget. We've cut back on some extras, the few that remained. However, the shortage was not limited to finances. We've sadly lost a tenant, and a pastor, and a few members. But through all this sacrifice, something else has happened. After the initial shock and subsequent waves of fear and anger and sadness, we got busy. We dried our tears, reached inside ourselves, and managed to find a new source of strength, creativity, and determination. As we were suddenly faced with a shortage, denied the things that we thought we needed to continue, we discovered something special, the willingness to make a change and thrive, showing our true colors. Our true colors, perhaps, were shining through. We celebrated our 190th anniversary in style. We improved the property. We've appeared multiple times in the newspaper, and dozens of new friends came through our doors. Even the spider plant in my office that was nearly dead has bloomed. None of this happened by accident. This happened because what was unique and special about each one of you found its way to the surface to accept the challenge of breathing life back into this church. So have you noticed the changes in the building and the gardens? Have you seen more new faces in the pews and in the fellowship hall for events? Did you know we're sending more mailings out and handing out welcome bags to visitors again? Have you heard children's voices in the hall? Are the conversations during coffee hour a little different? This is all because of you. What we have been through truly had the potential to squeeze the joy from us. These last several months were at times difficult to get through, but let's consider this. If we hadn't experienced this crisis, without being forced to face the challenge, we may never have realized how special we are and what we are capable of, and tap into something that was there all along, hope and joy. Where did we find joy in the midst of all this? True joy comes only through faith. In our reading today from Hebrews, the writer reminds us that God is mindful of us. God has created us a little lower than the angels, crowned us with glory and honor, subjecting all things under our feet, giving us everything we need. In Psalm 8, we've been given dominion over God's work. And according to Jesus in Matthew, we are the light of the world, and we must shine our light before others. What an awesome responsibility we have been given. And it's no surprise that we are tasked to pull upon all our special gifts, all our talents, our extra time, even a portion of our treasure, to ensure that the work of this church continues. But this miracle does not only apply to us here at church. If you think about it, you may realize that in the past, just as a blessing changed your perspective and your outlook, like a new job or a renewed relationship, a gift from a friend, an opportunity to travel, so does a challenge or crisis change our perspective and rearrange our priorities. The demise of a relationship, or the loss of a job, news of a loved one's illness, or our own. Everything changes, and we're not the same person we were before. Yes, we can become fearful, angry, and bitter. All of those feelings are understandable. But notice, too, that you may also have grown wiser, more patient. Perhaps you found value in some of the little things that you took for granted. And in the process, you may have grown closer to God. This transformation may not have happened had we not been challenged, had we not sacrificed. Here at church at the beginning of this year, we found ourselves sitting in darkness. We were facing some really difficult decisions, but from the depths of our being, we have uncovered a special, brilliant, radiant creativity. We have uncovered skills and talents we never knew were there. We have uncovered the Spirit of God within us. In John chapter 14, Jesus tells his disciples, "You will realize that I am in the Father, and you are in me, and I am in you." God is as close to us as our own breath. God is the source of our faith, our hope, our strength, our diligence, our creativity. God is the giver of the gifts you have within you, the things that make you special, the power to accept and get through challenges. God is the source of our true colors. What did the last few months feel like to you? You might answer, I'm so tired. Or, it was exhausting. Or, I need a break. But what special gift of yours found its way to the surface as we worked our way through this transition? Perhaps you are more outgoing, saying hello to people you haven't met. You've had the opportunity to invite friends to our service or one of our events. You may have been more attentive to the information that is shared with you through the mail or email. You found yourself feeling grateful or thankful for the work that's being done. You've been inspired to try something new. Perhaps you've transformed into a peacemaker or, on the other hand, a warrior determined not to let us fail. It's possible you're feeling joyful, refreshed, optimistic. Outgoing, attentive, grateful, inspired, joyful, refreshed, optimistic, all are adjectives that describe the qualities of exactly what it will take for us to continue to heal and flourish as individuals and as a church. It's the power that comes from what is special and unique about each and every one of us. It's those things that we are willing and eager to share. So again, I say, despite the sacrifice, and quite possibly because of the sacrifice, this year has revealed who and what we are as individuals and as Christ's church. We've been forced to reveal our true colors because of loss, sacrifice, pain, and anxiety. I believe that this experience has offered us a clear view of ourselves and not just who we are, but who we are becoming. And yes, we paid a high price. But it's not over. This is likely just the beginning. We will face more challenges, more obstacles, and we'll be invited again and again to pull upon our inner strength and creativity, perhaps in ways we haven't yet imagined. I pray that as this year draws to a close, we never forget the difficulties it brought us. But let us also remember the power it had to change us in a way that benefits ourselves and everyone around us. We are more thoughtful, more generous, more grateful, more aware, more hopeful, more faithful. This is the new life we're creating today for ourselves, for our church, and for everyone who walks through these doors. I want to close my homily today with the lyrics of a song by Cyndi Lauper called True Colors. As I read the verses to you, I want you to close your eyes and imagine the words are being whispered by Jesus just for you, because you are so special. You with the sad eyes, don't be discouraged. Oh, I realize it's hard to take courage. In a world full of people, you can lose sight of it all. And the darkness inside you can make you feel so small. But show me a smile, and then don't be unhappy. I can't remember when I last saw you laughing. If this world makes you crazy, and you've taken all you can bear, you call me up, because you know I'll be there. I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors, and that's why I love you. So don't be afraid to let them show. Your true colors are beautiful. Beautiful, like a rainbow. Amen. Our homily hymn is number 493, O Jesus, I Have Promised. Please stand in body or spirit. Service, the time when we, with one heart and mind, share our joys and concerns with God in prayer. I do not have the list that was filled out. Oh, thanks. Thank you. All right, so I do have a list. Are there others that we should include today in our prayer? Yes, Laura.
The Burton's children, well, they're not little.
Perkins?
Perkins.
I'm sorry to hear that. Any others? Yes, Mary.
Tim and his partner put in a purchase offer on a house and it was accepted.
Oh, how nice. Great. Any others? Yes, Lauren.
Dave Harris's birthday.
That's right, Dave Harris's birthday. I think there's two other birthdays this week, too.
Well, I have another birthday.
Yes.
And the flowers on the altar are in honor of Jamie, who is our first great-grandchild, who turns six this week. And her goal for learning in the first grade is to understand metamorphosis.
Wow.
And I do not think I even knew that word until I was 20, at least. So she's overwhelming and joyous at the same time.
So Jamie's sixth birthday. Great. All right, any others? Okay.
I noticed we do not have listed here the flood victims that occurred because of the hurricane, and that's just an unbelievable mess that we do need to pray for.
Yes, the flood as a result of the hurricane. I have that already, thank you. Let us now assume an attitude of prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we come before you recognizing your infinite love and grace. You are the source of all goodness and the giver of every perfect gift. Activate within us these gifts of the Holy Spirit and use us as vessels of your grace to bring light to the darkness and share the good news. We ask for the gift of wisdom that we might acknowledge your will in all circumstances. We ask for the gift of faith so that we may believe in the impossible and witness your power at work. We ask for the gift of healing, that through us you may bring comfort to those who are suffering. We pray today for those who are sick or in pain, for Sam, for Sue B. dealing with oral cancer, for Jean V. who's on chemo. Lord, let these, your children, and those who are caring for them feel your presence as you take them on their journey from sickness to health. In your mercy, Lord,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we lift up to you those of us who have suffered loss. We ask for you now to be with the Perkins family. We're dealing with the loss of their father. We know their loved ones are now free from suffering and pain, and you have welcomed them into your light. Stand beside those who are left behind to mourn their loss, Lord. Thank you for wrapping them in your love and granting them peace. In your mercy, Lord,
hear our prayer.
God, the news often frightens us and we feel overwhelmed. Be with the people of Gaza and Israel and Lebanon. Help them find their way to peace. Be with the people of Sudan who are suffering from civil war and starvation. Intervene in the war in the Ukraine. And God, be with the victims of Hurricane Helene, including those in Boone, North Carolina, where our former pastor Ron Brown's family lives. Lord, each and every day we pray for peace. Grant wisdom and compassion to the leaders, theirs and ours, that the choices they make and the actions they take will be done in consideration of the innocents. And bring hope and healing as the people suffering from this natural disaster work to recover their lives. In your mercy, Lord,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we always have a reason to celebrate the many blessings you have graciously granted. For our beautiful weather and the Apple Fest, for Laura's and Larry's and Dave Harris's birthdays this week, for Jamie's birthday, her sixth birthday, and the beautiful flowers on the altar. For Tim's new home, for the pleasure of mountain climbing and time with friends. We praise you, Lord, for the joyful moments you grant us each and every day that bring us happy tears, smiles, and laughter. In your mercy, Lord,
hear our prayer.
As we sit together in prayer in this holy space, there are things we hold deep in our hearts that we are unable to share. God, in this moment of silence, we offer to you our heartfelt prayers. Lord, we all need your unconditional love and guidance as we deal with things we cannot discuss with others. And we thank you for your peace and your forgiveness. In your mercy, Lord. God, we're grateful for all the gifts you've given us, especially the gift of your Son, Jesus, sent to walk this path of life with us. Let us never forget to call upon him in times of trouble or when we need the strength to live Christ-like lives. May we never be shaken by the challenges that life presents. For we know you have given us all the special gifts we need to see us through. We ask this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Service of worship where we acknowledge the gifts we have been given, gifts of time, of talent, of treasure, and our own personal gifts. For those who are here in the sanctuary, there's a receptacle near the entrance for your donations. For those of you who are watching us online, we thank you in advance for your financial support, sent through the mail or via our website. So let us now together ask God to bless our gifts. Gracious God, despite the sacrifices we have made in the last months, we are truly a wealthy people. We are rich in your grace and love that fulfills our every need. We have treasures within us that have been revealed to us through the difficulties we have faced. We have been given more than we need, thanks to your generosity. May our offering be used to spread your love and mercy to all those in need. Amen. Celebrating the sacrament of Holy Communion. This church participates in open communion. There is no requirement. Anyone who desires to be closer to God in this way is invited to join us, for Christ himself is the host. The choice to participate is yours. Please refer to your bulletin insert and follow along. For those of you who are with us online, take a moment now to get something that's juice and something that is bread, so that we can share this meal together as one. So let us begin by singing our communion hymn, number 343, Jesus Took the Bread.
Thank you.
Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hear these words of Jesus Christ. I am the bread of life. Anyone who comes to me shall not hunger. Anyone who believes in me shall never thirst. This table is open to all who confess Jesus as the Christ and seek to follow Christ's way. Come to this sacred table not because you must, but because you may. Come not because you are fulfilled, but because in your emptiness, you stand in need of God's mercy and assurance. Come not to express an opinion, but to seek a presence and to pray for a spirit. Come to this table then, sisters and brothers, as you are. Partake and share. It is spread for you and me that we might again know that God has come to us, shared our common lot, and invited us to join the people of God's new age. In preparation, let us now confess our sins. God of all mercy, we confess before you and each other that we have been unfaithful to you. We lack love for our neighbors, we waste opportunities to do good, and we look the other way when you cry out to us in the suffering voices of our brothers and sisters in need. We ask your forgiveness and pray for strength that we may follow in your way and love all your people with that perfect love which casts out all fear through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen. Hear these comforting words. If you believe in God's redeeming mercy, your sins are forgiven. Trust in God's promises and begin anew your life with God and all people in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to God.
Let us give thanks to God Most High.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Holy God, we praise and bless you for creation and the gift of life and for your abiding love, which brings us close to you, the source of all blessing. We thank you for revealing your will for us in the giving of the law, and in the preaching of the prophets. We thank you especially that in the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, born of Mary, to live in our midst, to share in our suffering, and to accept the pain of death at the hands of those whom Jesus loved. We rejoice that in a perfect victory over the grave, you raised Christ with power to become sovereign in your realm. We celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit to gather your church, by which your work may be done in the world and through which we share the gift of eternal life. With the faithful in every place and time, we praise with joy your holy name. Holy, 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 God of love and majesty, the whole universe speaks of your glory, O God Most High. We remember that on the night of betrayal and desertion, Jesus took bread. Gave you thanks. He broke the bread and gave it to the disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, Jesus also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Consecrate, therefore, by your Holy Spirit these gifts of bread and wine, and bless us, that as we receive them at this table, we may offer you our faith and praise, we may be united with Christ and with one another, and we may continue to be faithful in all things. In the strength Christ gives us, we offer ourselves to you, eternal God, and give thanks that you have called us to serve you. Amen. Through the broken bread, we participate in the body of Christ. Through the cup of blessing, we participate in the new life Christ gives. Come, for all things are ready. The elements will now be delivered directly to you. Please hold them until we can share this holy meal together as one unified body. Eat this, for it is the body of Christ broken for you. Drink this, for it is the blood of Christ shed for you. Please join me in prayer. We thank you, God, for inviting us to this table, where we have known the presence of Christ and have received all Christ's gifts. Increase our faith, amplify our love for one another, and let us show forth your praise in our lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Now that we have been fed by this holy meal, let us go forth into the world, strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, help the afflicted, and love and serve God. Amen. Please respond to each other in peace with an embrace, a handshake, or a kind word. Thank you. Our hymn of parting is number 495, called As Partners in Christ's Service. If you would please stand in body or spirit, Laura will play through it once to give us all a chance to find the page. Benediction, I want to share something with you. A friend of mine, I'll call her Helen, struggled with mental illness. After the loss of her mother, she suffered from an overwhelming feeling that everything in her life was out of her control, and it was too much to handle. As a result, her relationships, her career, her home all fell into disrepair. But she found a confidant, a counselor, and is slowly finding her way back. She's recognizing her strengths and her gifts. As she does the work to heal, she has created colorful little cards that have descriptive words on them, words that identify the special gifts that she and we all have. She has given me a set of those cards, and I have them here today to share with you as you leave the sanctuary. When you look at the cards you've been given, think about the words that are written on them and decide if they are gifts you carry, and maybe you'll discover one you haven't uncovered yet. And now, let us go forth into the new seasons of our lives and show our true colors. Let us go with caring awareness for the world and all that is in it. Let us be led out in joy and in peace.